Okay. Okay. I see it. Thank you guys for coming back. Thanks for coming back. I just had to, there we go. There's Stephanie. There's our star. There she is.
Hi, I'm back.
Hey, Stephanie. Thanks for coming back. So one of the questions I wanted to ask, you said something that was so powerful. You said, you know, about 2 or 3 years ago, you started, you know, kind of sitting in your the seat of your power and confidence, and it didn't happen until about 2 or 3 years ago. What do you think are the things when you were making the analogy to the bell curve in terms of how long it will take for you to get back to your centered spot, just how long it took you to kind of spiral, live in a spiraling world. So what were some things that you think you did or that occurred in your life that allowed you to get to a point 2, 3 years ago where you're like, you know who I am? I'm a survivor. I am sitting in my power. My words are my story, and they hold power and truth that will help other people as well as have helped me. What happened?
What happened? What was it? A single event.
I know it never is.
I think it's a journey, and I think they're baby steps. So when everything, let's back up to where I was in the hospital. I was a month in the hospital, month in a wheelchair, month in a walker, had a year of physical therapy, basically had to learn to walk again. I think I mistakenly believed that when I was physically healed, everything else, the world would just kind of all be right again. And I could go about being the same kind of mom that I was before the shooting, as I just pick up the pieces and move forward.
Sure.
Well, it didn't work out quite that way. You know, I spent a good couple of years trying to save our assets in the business in Champaign, Illinois.
And were you able to go?
Nope. Everything went away. And
how many people know that this woman lost her entire life?
Lost everything.
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 That's a big thing. So the reason why I said I want people to know that is, again, going back to the types of questions that one forms and asks someone in your position. When you consider that someone has lost everything, everything, their whole lives, and they've encountered a situation they never saw coming, they never thought, that is horrific. You know, one day I was driving home from work several years ago, and there was this guy on the side of the road, and he just had this sign. And it was, you know, it was at the stoplight, and he just had his cardboard sign, and he was sitting on the ground, and on his cardboard sign, his shoulders were down. He just had this, the word help on it. And I looked over at him, and I spontaneously started crying. It was just such this deep, like, call for help. Like, I just need help. I don't have a story to tell you. I don't have anything to say. Like, I haven't eaten. All I know is I need help. And for some reason in that moment, the gift that he gave me is that I looked at him. I realized, maybe if every person who I have ever loved and who loves me and they're no longer here, maybe I could be right there. I feel like when I saw him, for some reason, I saw that the perfect confluence of pain, destruction, and heartache, that could be me. I could be sitting there on the road with a sign that says, help. I don't have any other words. I have no more story to tell you, but I need help. And so my point is, your story, I want people to really get this. This woman lost everything, everything. So please keep going.
Thank you. Thank you. So yeah, everything went away, and professionally, there was really nothing for me to do in Champaign. It's a college town, and I didn't have any assets, and I really didn't know what I was going to do. So I remember going to my parents and telling them, actually on Mother's Day, that we needed to go somewhere new. We needed to start over. My oldest was going to be a freshman in college, and he was attending University of Kentucky, and my second son had, the one that had called 911 on the house phone, had gone to finish high school with my parents. He went to go live with them for 3 years because, I mean, there was so much trauma in it, and I wasn't a good parent. I just wasn't an effective parent. I didn't have the strength.
You were trying to live.
Yeah. And so to this day, it's something I wish I never had to do, but yet I think it helped. I don't think he would be the amazing young man that he is today if that sacrifice wasn't made, but yeah. It was really hard to do. So
it was the right thing. It was the right thing. You need to take care of you. So, it's the right thing.
Today, he's a mechanical engineer and graduate.
Well, go ahead, girl.
Thank you. So I'm very proud. I love
you
him.
You should
so
be.
Much. I'm so proud of him. But anyhow, so I had the two younger ones, and we're like, okay, we need to start over. So we picked Dallas to come live. My brother has been here for a number of years.
So you had a support. You had a support system there.
Yes. He is a... he's a doctor here, and
fancy and pants.
Our children are—they have three children, and between their three and my two younger ones, we have five kids that are all a year apart. So
that's awesome. First cousins, I love that.
And we're very close, which is wonderful. But anyhow, we moved here in August of 2012. And
okay.
I didn't have a job. I am very thankful for my family. I have an amazing support structure. My parents stepped up. My mother especially helped me get a house. Because again, I had no financial resources.
That's right.
Everything was an influx, and I was trying to wind down and manage the estate, and there just wasn't anything left. So we found a house. We moved in August 1, 2012, like I said, and I went back to work in January in tax season and worked in public accounting, hated it, and was trying to manage, trying to figure out how to rebuild my career and
how'd you do that?
Raise a family. So I took one job and it was awful. And then I left and took another job, and I was very underhired. Like, I think the next position I had was as a senior accountant for one of the largest real estate management companies in the country. Was miserable. And it wasn't a good fit. I had a horrible commute, but it's what I had to do. And so I bid my time there. And then took the next position where I was a corporate accounting manager, which was a little bit more kind of my skill set.
Yeah.
And worked there for a year. And then another job opportunity came along, and I moved to the position I am today, where I'm a financial controller for a real estate developer that does large industrial logistics, e-commerce facilities in the Metroplex, the Dallas Metroplex.
So tell me this. So what I want people to hear, though, is because now I do want you to tell a bit of the wonderfulness that's happening in your world. But what I do want people to understand is it was step by step by step. It was a huge thing to rebuild a life.
Yes.
To rebuild a life.
So, and I kind of glossed all over that.
Yes,
so
you did.
Moving to Dallas was very different. We're in suburban Dallas. We're in the Plano Frisco area.
Sure.
And when we moved here, I was the only working mom in my daughter's third grade class. And it was very difficult to make friends. It was very difficult to find my people, to find my lane. The school that my children came from, both parents, I mean, first of all, we were in a college town. Sure. So we were accustomed to both parents working. Both were doctors, or one was an attorney and one was a professor or whatever.
She's a strong woman.
There were two breadwinners, or there was
very no. And by the way, whatever a family needs for that family to live, that's what that family needs, and everybody needs to just shut their mouth. Keep going.
But there was a very different cultural norm here that I totally
in the South
didn't expect. It totally blindsided me.
Like I told you, my daughter, she told me, I live in Charlotte, North Carolina, and she told me this season, she's like, in her cheerleading thing, she goes, my coach says that you're the only mom she hasn't met.
You know what? My daughter just is going to do a cheer team this year, and I'm terrified because I think I'm going to be, we're going to be having more conversations.
I was like, well, mommy is working and she's met your father, so that should be good enough.
I hear you. The whole cheer thing, I'm terrified.
It is scary.
I've made it to this point of my life without wearing one of those t-shirts that say cheer mom. It's like, oh God,
welcome.
Yeah, we're gonna have to have a follow-up chat about that. I think
I'm not the greatest at it.
Yeah, so it was, and then I'm working tax season, so my kids are home by themselves. I've got neighbors, you know, I've got family that can check on them, but it was just really, it was a very lonely existence. It was a very, very lonely place.
Yeah, you felt like you were in your own silo.
Totally. Mm-hmm. And
I felt that.
I think after about 3 years, I didn't know if I was going to make it here. I was like, and I also felt like, what is wrong with me? I've never had a hard time making friends. I've never had a hard time being plugged in, and it was just such a different local culture for me that I really struggled. Now that I have time to reflect on that, or I have had as I've kind of come out of that place, I also know that part of that was on me and that I just didn't have the bandwidth. I mean, again, I was in that daily survival mode. Just getting through every day was such a struggle. So I finally landed the right job. You know, I'm trying to keep everything balanced with the kids and I finally got to, I think, the position I am today. And just as I would do more, I think my confidence kind of started to come back gradually.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very fortunate that I work for a man who empowers me and challenges me, gives me the freedom to be a mom, but as long as I get the work done, and gives me that flexibility. And that's one thing I would challenge every person, man or woman, mm-hmm. that isn't in the career that feels right or in the mm-hmm. job, even within their career. This might not be the right time because of the economic issues we're dealing
with. Say it, girl. Say it.
Keep looking. Keep striving. Keep your eyes open for new opportunities and don't be afraid to change. Don't be afraid to shift lanes, to move to a new place. You know, I mean, you have to do it with some common sense and some wisdom, you know, whatever your financial needs are, whatever that is. But don't be afraid to take a risk and do something different if you are miserable in your current situation. So professionally, that's where I was for years. Somewhere along the way, this was a whim, a total whim to go back to grad school.
Mm-hmm.
Total whim. And so I applied to go to Georgetown mm-hmm. and their Master's of Real Estate Studies. Again, mm-hmm. most of my professional career has been in the real estate accounting and finance arena.
Sure.
So there was an online program. I'm like, okay, it's Georgetown.
Why not?
And I'm like, all right, I'll apply. And I didn't think I'd get in. I didn't think I'd get in, I don't know, but I didn't think I got in. And I was
of course
like,
you did.
Holy shit, I just got into Georgetown.
I love it. Yes. So you did.
And then I went through the master's program and I got all A's. And
of course you did.
I graduated. And
yeah.
So one of the things I want to say is that so many of us come from a place where we're so defeated, where we have no confidence in our own ability
mm-hmm.
to do things, to, you know, to be the amazing people that, you know, that we can.
Yeah.
And it may be baby steps to get there, but you take one risk, you know, and the other thing, I was like, okay, what do I have to lose? If I don't get accepted, nobody has to know that I applied. If I don't do well, I don't finish the program, nobody has to know that I did this, you know?
Absolutely.
So I would talk myself into all of these scenarios that made it okay or made it comfortable for
to
me
try.
To give it a shot. Right.
You know what I'm telling myself right now? So you've been kind enough to let me interview you. I know this is an honor and I appreciate it. And I am reaching out to people every day. Like there's a brother in Ireland, a Franciscan monk, who wrote this viral poem called Lockdown.
Okay.
I just reached out to him. And I said, can I talk with you? And you know what he said? Yes. This is what I'm
Isn't
telling you.
Isn't that
people.
Amazing?
Yes, because.
Right. And then this when is that the thing. Happens,
It gives you air to do it the next time.
Right,
but this is really what I want to say. I do really want to say this. Today, Beyonce is not in my world. Oprah is not a friend of mine. Tyler Perry is not on my speed dial.
But it's in our future, right?
So if I reach out to them and they do not reach out to me, my life is unchanged. They're already not a part of my life. If I reach out to them and they reach back, what could change? Right. What could change? I have nothing to lose. So I just wrote Lady Gaga yesterday.
I love it. I love it. I love it.
Yeah. So that's exactly what you're saying.
It's so, so true. So,
Oh,
and,
I love that.
And one door, and if you just put yourself out there just a little bit,
yep.
One door opens another. So,
yep.
You know, it's kind of the lane you and I are in. We talk about speaking and all of these things. And I had all these amazing opportunities until coronavirus hit.
That's all right. It's going to come back. It's going to come back.
Yes, the reschedule.
And you're going to take lessons from all of what you're encountering right now during the Rona.
Right. And they will come back. And
that's
I look at this time now that the world is pretty much shut down to kind of be a place to recalibrate, to refocus, and to, again, go inside a little deeper to so that that messaging, whatever it is for anybody out there, can be, it can be a little clearer, a little crisper, and evolves into something that can be even that much more transformational for other people.
I have one more question for you.
Sure.
Do you think you could be the person right now today that can rebuild a life from, you know, Mount Vesuvius exploding if your life had not been ripped from you? Do you think you could be the person who is building a new life?
No, not at all.
Hey,
nor could my children be the amazing creatures that they are today. No, absolutely not.
The reason why I'm asking the question is because this goes to my intention of interviewing you. Mm-hmm. We think that we need perfect parts to create a perfect and beautiful whole. But the truth is we kind of need these broken, fractured. It's not that I wish this to happen to you. It's not like I'm celebrating that this happened to you at all, but it did happen to you.
Right.
And it's now a part of your story. And what is amazing is how now you take, it's incumbent upon us. This is the life that God has blessed us. So it's incumbent upon us to lead the most magnificent version of this life as possible. And what you have to do is you have to build that with what you have. And I don't think, had your life not been ripped, would you be the type of person who can go to a new city and establish herself and create a whole new life for her and her children?
No, you're on point with that all the way, Shay. Totally on point. And when I tell people, what happened was crap. It was
horrible.
It was the most god-awful thing anybody could
horrible.
Go through. However, when I say I'm thankful and blessed, I'm thankful and blessed.
You are.
I have a great life. I've created this life. It's what I want it to look like. And
yes.
I'm done. And if...
Getting me excited.
And I... You know, and I've set an example for my children. Hopefully someday it will resonate with them that they can do whatever they want or be whatever they want to be. And everybody goes through crap. Like I've told I've tried to raise them with, what happened to us was bad. It was really bad. And I think there was an embarrassment. There was
shame.
Internalization that we're our family's a freak show. You know, we are that shocking story that nobody would imagine. And people might think differently of us if they know our truth. And what I've tried to instill in them is that everybody goes through crap. Everybody has it. It's just ours is really public. The shooting was at 4:00. We were on the 5:00 news in a town of about 150,000 people.
Nice.
Everybody knew.
So it was just messy.
No, it was. Mm-hmm. And so from the beginning, I've been very public about what happened because I was never afforded the luxury of being private. And I think that as my children grow up and mature and find themselves, they will someday come to appreciate that because they then have the tools in their wheelhouse to help their friends, their, you know, extended family members deal with tragedy, and they'll be better equipped to deal with their own, because we all know we all have to deal with nonsense in our lives that's unpredictable. So they will have that, those tools in their wheelhouse to get to the other side.
Absolutely. Oh, are you happy today, Stephanie?
Yeah, I am. I mean,
are you dating?
No, no.
Okay. No. We're putting that out there.
Okay. Dallas is a really, no.
what's wrong with it? What's up with Dallas?
I mean, I just, again, you know, part of that whole cultural thing. I just, Dallas is a hard place to date, and that's a whole other conversation.
We'll get that one offline.
But we will
talk about that one offline for sure.
But yeah, no, I'm happy. I'm blessed. I don't know where this journey is going to take me. But I'm, you know, I've created a pretty fun life, pretty exciting life. And I think
a strong life,
a lot out there in my future, and I'm just want to embrace it. You know, that's what it's all about.
Just getting Stephanie, and you are amazing. You're amazing. No, you really are. And I appreciate this time so greatly. I know we're about to get off, but I just wanted to say, I often think about this when I interface with people who share their stories with me, is that, you know, I find that the stories we most want to hear and the stories that change our lives are the stories that are always the hardest to have lived. They always are.
You're probably, yeah. You know, one thing I want to leave with that is the one, I never want my story to just be the salacious, seedy,
right,
Lifetime movie network story.
It's
that's not.
Not
my goal of sharing. It's
and
not
that's not my goal in asking.
Right. And, mm-hmm. and, but I do think the coming out of it is really the message, the power of my story, and
absolutely.
How you don't have to be stuck. You know, so many women in domestic violence situations are stuck. Mm-hmm. And they're embarrassed. And we can, you've heard me say this, and we can kind of leave on this, is that if one in four women statistically are in an abusive relationship.
That's a lot.
It's a lot. And I don't care if it's one in three. I don't care if it's one in five. I didn't believe the statistic until it was me. And mm-hmm. then I started sharing. And then I had all of these women, especially in corporate America, come up to me at the water cooler and say, well, this happened to me too. But don't tell anyone, because I might be judged. My boss might look at me differently. Nobody knows this. I'm not going to prosecute, blah, blah, blah. And again, I was never afforded that luxury. So I've never lived that way. But it happens in corporate America as well. So what I have found is that women still are stuck with the shame, with the why me, kind of the topics we were talking about earlier. And if you're stuck in that place in your head, then you're cheating yourself of the ability to have an amazing life.
Yes.
Down the road.
Yes.
You've got to let that go. Mm-hmm. And you've got to accept it and just move on. It's not you.
Yeah.
You know, you doing the best you can in your situation. You know, I did the best.
It's true. Everybody does.
I have, and the resources that I had.
That's right.
The worst thing I could do for me and my children is to internalize that and be stuck in that place. So,
oh my God.
Anyhow.
Stephanie, I love you.
Love you too.
I love you, love you, love you. And I appreciate you sharing this with us. You go and have a beautiful day, and I'll probably call you offline. Thank you guys for showing up. And I know, I'm telling you, you save people's lives and you help people with their life wherever they are.
All right. Blessed to know you, girl.
Bye, beautiful.
Okay, bye-bye.